as you just mentioned there, the debate will be that we will fully consult and we will develop that education campaign on the measures. The issue will be that if I run, we continue to not pick up after the dark, and it will be how do we tackle that issue as a council? That is the issue that it will boil down to. In terms of the measures, I'm sure we'll develop an education camp program in some scenarios past there. But will education be enough on the issue of those people who just refuse to pick up their dogs in areas where the dogs should be dug anyway?
Thank you, Chair. Good evening, Mr. Coven. Just two very, very quick points. Just put it right in my mind that you're not bringing it back in the autumn, because that's when we happen to have our next meeting. And if that is the case, then I'd like to see the report before then. The consultation that you're thinking of having, I do tend to take Councillor Spratt's comment, if you always do what you always do, you always get what you always had, and we just need to visit this in a different way, because it was an almighty cock-up last time, and I think we need to take the public with us, as opposed to being draconian, which was what we had that last time. So, really, my first question, I suppose, was the one I wanted to answer to. Is it going to be ready before the 24th of September, or are you just leaving it until then, because that's when my next meeting?
We'll present the report to the committee as soon as we can.
Okay. Any other questions?
I've got some words I've scribbled down during the conversation that I would like to use as a
committee have recommended to us, it says, note the position reached in relation to the consideration of future flood control measures. And it is a cabinet member to withdraw in its entirety the existing PFPO proposals and engage with user groups such as Wirral clubs, Friends of Birken and Kennels and others, but not exclusively them, any groups, to ensure that their views are taken into account before any future PFPO proposals are brought forward for consideration. I'll move that. Okay. Can we have a vote on that? All those in favour? Item 8, future position provisions of the Floral Pavilion. I have here Colin Clayton, Dave McKenzie, and Matthew Humble.
Progressing this recommended council option has included engagement and consultation to ensure we choose the right specialist. Consultation has been undertaken, including specific questions relating to this project as part of the budget consultation process. A communication and engagement plan is in place of when, how, and members of residents, staff, and TUs will be consulted. Although a lot of work has been done in this area, as advised in the brief statement, additional engagement work will be undertaken, and we will bring this engagement to results of this back to members. In terms of the financial aspects covered in the report, members have been informed that recommendations to progress this option were set against the significant financial challenges that the Wirral Council faces, and the current annual budget cost to continue delivering the floral in-house is £899,000 per annum. And the final figures for budget spend at the end of 18-19 was £1.137 million in some overspend. While I would commend the staff and the management at the floral, and significant work has been done over a number of years to develop commercial opportunities such as wedding, extended bar, increasing secondary spend, and the development of a marketing campaign to attract new business. If not considered within the report option, the council will be able to reduce these annual costs significantly in the medium term without pursuing the recommended option. Whilst we did consider in the report commercial management option, it's only projected that the highest likely savings to ensure the long-term sustainability of this vibrant centre of cultural excellence was to the lease to a specialist theatre operator. The savings from this transfer is expected to deliver an annual saving of £550,000 with one-off capital receipt. In terms of marketing the floral to identify a suitable specialist operator, Lambert Smith and Hampton appointed to prepare the marketing material for the floral pavilion and undertake a targeted marketing campaign which commenced on the 31st of May and is due to end on the 15th of July 2019. We have already received some very positive interest, and once all the submissions are received, we ensure that the submissions are appropriately evaluated to identify the most appropriate provider. You'll note in my pre-statement that we have committed to more additional consultation, which we will share with members ensure that we're all fully informed of our stakeholder views before the evaluation stage. The recommendation is that members know the report. I have asked my colleagues and I have asked people from the programme manager and David McKenzie, the senior manager of the floral, to assist in any questions that members may have. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Members, questions? No questions? I have a couple of questions, and I asked the officer yesterday. I'm not a theatre guy. I go now and again. I am told that a specialist theatre operator will have equal difficulty that we currently have at Floral, because of the technical specification, it doesn't have a fly house. What the fly heights I understand is how big you can build sets, etc., etc. It looks like that doesn't exist. We're also competing with a theatre, 2,500-seat theatre, the Empire Theatre, which is 20 minutes away. I'm told, and I stopped just to check, that the Empire Theatre employ 12 full-time staff. And yet the Floral Pavilion, we have 38 full-time staff for the reports. Can any voice be thrown upon those observations?
Yes, Chair. We'll answer any of those points as I can, and then we'll ask my colleague. terms of what some of these companies do is bring in this specialist when a new purchase or lease to use all this in-house experience that they've got to develop the business. And this type of expertise is probably well beyond the council's budget. So that's kind of one element. In terms of the staff, I'd be pleased to kind of pick them up. It's my understanding that the Empire has a very different model. A lot of their work and a lot of their back office work and things are done in their central headquarters in London. So what you've got actually operating is the very basics of the Empire, and a lot of their shows bring their production management team, their sound tech people, etc. I don't know if you'd be able to add to that. Is that a picture?
Yes, Colin is right. The Empire is run by ATG, who have a portfolio of 30 plus venues, which really is accurate. And Colin's right, they do operate a central department based in London, who program their theatres regionally, so they have a regional program for the North West, for example. I presume the figures you've quoted, I don't know the exact figures of the Empire staffing structure. I would expect them not to include those elements. So Floral Pavilion as a single entity has to employ a programme and a market to get shows in and sell them, but I would suspect that they might not be that members with any of these entities.
Thank you.
Just fly. So, going back 12 years when the Floral Pavilion was from memory, the rest of Virginia Road protested against the fly tower that was proposed. It was due to be double the height it currently is. So there was due to be a fly tower in place. However, the architects and designers at the time were very clever in how they manipulated the theatre, especially on stage, and they created a double purchase cancelling system, which basically means you can cram the fly system into a much smaller space. It's not ideal, it makes it very difficult, but that doesn't stop us attracting shows that I would say are suitable for the outside.
Thank you, Matt.
We've answered your points here.
You have some points, yeah?
Thank you.
Any members have any questions following that? Yes, Brian.
Yeah, thanks, Jim. First of all, to be honest, with respect, I don't necessarily see that the Floral Pavilion is in competition with the Empire. Because I would imagine a lot of people who live in the Wirral are happy to go to the Floral Pavilion. And there are some really good shows on there. I mean, I live just 2 minutes walk away from it, and I've been to lots of really good productions there myself. But I suspect a lot of the people who live in the Wirral don't necessarily feel that they'd be as happy going over to Liverpool, to the Empire, because of parking problems, transport problems, etc. So I think it is important that we do retain a good theatre venue in the Wirral, and I think the Floral Pavilion is a good theatre venue. I am heartened with what you said, Colin, that you've had discussions with the staff, with volunteers and with the trade unions, and I hope that will continue, because I think that's an important aspect of this, that the staff who are employed there now, presumably some of them are a little bit worried about the future. So I hope those consultations will continue. But we can't get away from the fact that you said we're losing money. We're losing what? $500,000 or more every year. And it does beg the question, is it our job as a council to run a theatre? And if you think about it, probably the answer is no, because there are companies out there who are experts in running theatres. And if there's a company out there who's willing to give the guarantee that it will carry on as a theatre venue, and I think we would need that sort of guarantee, I think we've got to look at that option. And again, I don't think we're being asked to make a decision tonight, but if what you're saying is you're considering the options of getting another company to come in to run the Floral Pavilion and save us between $500,000 and $1 million a year, and at the same time, the public in the Wirral have still got a guarantee that they're going to have a good theatre with top name acts, etc., being in there, and I, for one, I'm happy to go along with that. Again, as I understand it, you're not recommending anything tonight other than we know the current position, and I'm presuming that a formal recommendation, once you've had further discussions, will come back to this committee at a future stage, and I'm happy to leave it on that basis.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair.
Chair, can I just make a comment? I think the staff should be commended when we met them. We asked them, as we go forward in negotiating, we want to make sure that we get the right provider. They asked some really excellent, well-considered questions and made some really good comments that we're going to feed into the process, including make sure that during this we consider our loyal customers that use the floor. So I think just on that, I'd like to commend the staff for their participation and hospitality. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Pinnon.
Thanks for that comment. I'm being a simplistic soul, think to myself, if a company can run it, why can't we employ somebody to run it, a specialist to run it, and we take the profits? Because I don't always accept what Brian says about local theatre, because from where I live, in Clatterbridge, it's much easier for me to go to Liverpool on the bus, it's one bus service that we have got, which takes a lot shorter time than going to Brighton on the bus. And I can go easily go to the shows. But in fact, those sort of shows that they have at the Floral are really good, especially the children's ones, and they're full. I would like to see which shows are full, which shows aren't full, how many local groups use the Floral, like the dance schools and the like. Why does it have its own youth theatre? Because that brings in so much money. I mean, people have fabulous lifestyles if they will use theatre, some people. And it's a community thing. It'd be ideal for people to learn, young people to learn, not just acting on stage, but all the sound, the sets, the costume, everything. None of that ever seems to be explored, and we've got such good staff there. They have to deal with ridiculous things, really, like when it's busy, the toilets stop working in the ladies at half time, and they have to explain to people and stay polite and nice to people when they must be answering the same question at the time. And it's so much enjoyed, because I can't see why we can't look at employing somebody. We've employed people for other things, and now we've got to change the way we look at running a local authority, and we can't say anymore we were employed local government officers, because we all know you've got to be a specialist to run a theatre, and we could employ that person. At least we could look at it, because then we're not losing that. And we don't know what's going to happen in the future. And we don't do enough over wedding venues, we don't do enough over conference. We need a hotel there, that's clear. We need a good hotel in New Brighton, we should produce as well. And with all that combined, it would be a success, and we would make money. We would be losing 1.3 something million, which I don't think we're actually losing, because I don't think the way it's run like a theatre. And I think that's what's wrong with it as well. A question we asked in the budget discussions was about when people were told, when the staff were told about cutting that. It was a cutting exercise. But if that had been a theatre, it would have been how do we get more people in type exercise. And I just think we're tying the staff's hands behind the backs, in a way.
Firstly, Chair, thank you, Constable, for the advice you've done. Firstly, it's much appreciated. I don't make a back to you. In terms of answering the elements of those questions,
options for running the theatre in the future. The in-house option was considered. As a mid-scale theatre, standing on its own, it does have limitations. Limitations that you wouldn't get with a larger chain, which have economies of scale, as Colin has mentioned. That's what to say that the staff and management haven't tried to increase the amount of income that has come in. They've looked at increasing the marketing efforts, they've looked at the box office, they've looked at trying different ways of running the bar, putting on the bar after hours. They've developed the comfort side of the theatre and also the wedding venue business, as well as diversifying into all the live music. The projection from the in-house model is that year on year the subsidy is coming down, and it's coming down slowly. So by the time we get to 2020-21, it's still projected to cost the local authority £761,000 in subsidy. Under a contract option, so we could seek to contract out the theatre to an experienced operator. And under that contract option, from day one, looking at sorts of reductions from other local authorities and other theatres, we'd expect the subsidy to reduce to, I believe it's £750,000 a year. And obviously there'd be points in that contract where we could renegotiate terms in order to bring it down further. But any alternative operator under a contract won't accept any risk. They're looking to make some money out of it themselves. So it's always that headline figure in a contract where the operator will be wanting the profit. So the option that was put forward was the lease as a going concern, where an operator does have those freedoms to explore commercial and income generation opportunities. But as I say, we're looking for a specialist idea, we're looking for a chain that brings with them those economies of scale. And it moves the council from a different position of having to subsidise it because we're directly providing it into a position where we don't. And it's for that reason that the option of leasing the theatre as a going concern was actually the preferred option.
Thank you, Matthew.
Answer the question around show capacity. So the floor film last year operated in terms of audience numbers at around 60% capacity. And UK Theatre Association benchmarked that data for seating theatres of between 500 and 1,000 seats at 56%. So we're above 4% above the national average, which I think shows you that the shows we're putting on are being attended. In terms of local groups, and I think we can break that down, information down further if you do request it. We do that all over here today, we can do that. Local groups, in terms of that, local groups are a fundamental part of our business. We engage with them so much, year after year after year. They look after us by returning, we look after them by providing them good service. And that ranges from dance schools, schools, local amateur dramatics, and as part of the business actually I think works in every sense. I think something we should be very proud of, what we've got, what we've sustained over the long term. You know, Tans have been up there for over 100 years now, you know, and you know, other schools and other organisations and similar. In relation to the youth theatre, it's something we haven't explored, but you know, I think that's what we mentioned, we could explore that, how much of the cost of that, how that would work for an organisation that's already trying to reduce its subsidy. And the weddings and conference centre, I think the only thing that can really answer that, apart from Dylan Nesney, really is that we are focusing on that. There's some work in the capital bid application that we put into help us develop that further.
important to note that the Floral Pavilion was rebuilt in its form opening was the 18th of December 2008. It's 10 years old. It's comparatively young with the theatre's going. We don't envisage significant capital costs arising from the theatre at all. It is in good condition. We're really expecting these holding to maintain it in that sort of condition. So any provider coming in, thinking about, we don't want to spend a lot of capital on the long lease, that doesn't really arise for the building. It's one of the only theatres you can look at.
In terms of selling off the family deals, just make a comment, please. What we've made an absolute commitment to in my discussions with council and Wales is it's about finding the right specialist provider to make sure that it stays offering the great shows for the future. So in terms of feedback from the staff, and obviously we're looking to them to this committee as well to feed back into, it's not about just finding any provider, it's about finding the right provider for our floor.
And we lose about £22,000 a week to keep the place open. Then are we looking at about £22,000 a week? Sorry. Are we looking at about £22,000 a week to keep the place running?
I think that's about right. The achievable target.
Only divided the figure here by 52. Yeah. That's all.
Yeah. I think from the £899,000 this cap cost. Cost that would always remain with the council. So when they sold it, we own the building. So that's why we said that.
With the withdrawal, we spent that £1,100,000. So if you divide that by 52, it's just under 22,000, isn't it?
Yeah.
So you've got to try and draw, or someone's got to try and draw the chapters in and produce that or something like that.
Would you like
to
know
what
these
are? Sorry, didn't know that. So we've got to find someone or have an officer who can produce a turnover every week.
Yes.
Any other questions? Could I just ask again? You said you've advertised the long use. What sort of lease time have you advertised it for? And secondly, we would still be the landlord, so would we still be responsible for major costs if something went wrong with you?
I know Mark's going to come into this, but I think I may partly answer it. It's kind of commercially sensitive in terms of, so we're happy to reveal that kind of off the record, if that's okay, Chair. And in terms of, we want to wait to see that it comes in, and we want to get the best deal we can, probably the shortest period possible. So in terms of, we're going to have to accept that we're looking for the right specialist here to help us to invest in the number of decades that they'll probably want to complete. The second part of the question.
As a landlord, we still be responsible for major works if you're required and the cost of it?
We would be building that into the contract that they are responsible and liable for those costs. Sorry, I'll just make sure. Thank you.
What we're looking for is a full repair of maintenance and so on. So any of these holes coming in, we also want to carry out the road condition survey, just to be aware of any cheap capital works, and that would be part of the negotiation. We're not expecting any big capital works, because as I say, it's 10 years old. But we would be requiring a new lease offer to carry out all the repair and maintenance that's required while the lease is in place.
Anybody else? Okay, we have a recommendation. I'd just like to add a little sentence to it. By saying we'd like to thank the new cabinet member for his role in carrying out further consultation to make sure we get the right answers and the report. We'll have with that? Okay. Thank you. Item 9, future provision of golf courses. We have Colin to you and Matthew. Thank you.
Chair, once again, for your permission, I'd like to provide an update statement, please, before we introduce the report. I'd like to present a short statement which provides some significant updates and feedback on certain aspects of the report since it was published. As previously advised, as a newly appointed assistant director of community services, I'm now responsible for the teams that have been tasked to support our newly appointed cabinet member to find a way forward which takes into account the views, concerns of members of this committee, the residents and golf club members that may be affected by this option. Members of this committee will be aware that our call in on the delegated decision to select the preferred provider to enter into negotiations with was convened on Tuesday the 18th of June 2019. Since that meeting, I have received instructions from the Cabinet Member, Councillor Harris, to address the points of concern raised by members of this committee. The Cabinet Member has also given clear instructions that further consultations should take place to understand and inform options for the future of our golf courses. This will include work with this committee, trade unions, users and the golf clubs in order to find the right way forward. As such, the Cabinet Member has suggested pausing current proposals for our golf courses while this additional work is undertaken. I have also personally reflected and fully accepted feedback from members at last week's calling. I would like to give you my commitment and the commitment of the teams involved that we will endeavour to address all the issues that you've raised. I would also like to add, during the meeting of the 18th of June, a number of questions were raised that office were not in a position to answer. Written responses have now been provided to members of this committee. We are also absolutely committed to providing members of this committee with all the information you need. Going forward, we as officers will endeavour to be able to respond to your questions, and if we cannot, on the night, we can be promised to respond in writing within the shortest time periods. If members have any comments or questions about this opening statement, I'd be happy to take them. Otherwise, I'll continue on to the report, please, Chair.
Thank you. Any questions for that opening statement? No? Please continue, Colin.
Dear members, I'd now like to present some key points from the actual report as an introductory summary. The progress the update report has provided relates to work undertaken to take forward the council agreed decision that was taken on the 4th of March 2019, which was to transfer Arrow Park and the Wirral Municipal Golf Courses to an alternative specialist provider on a long lease, while the council retained freehold ownership. Several options for the future provision of the golf club above courses were considered by Cabinet on the 26th of November 2018 and have been through a number of scrutiny processes. This budget option was agreed by budget councillors, representing the most appropriate opportunity for savings in the long term while keeping the courses open for the benefits of residents and visitors to work. The proposal included embedding in the option restricted covenants which would, throughout the period of the lease, ensure that the course could only be used as a golf course and that pay and play must be offered, thus ensuring that the future of the courses would be open and accessible to all. The option offered a number of benefits, including reducing the current revenue expenditure that Borough Council has to pay towards keeping the courses open, negating the risk of Borough Council having to cover any overspends from its revenue budget, and by transferring the responsibility of investing the capital costs needed these courses up to a standard for new specialists provided for the long-term benefits of the course and its users. In terms of engagement, my opening statements detail that our Cabinet Member, Councillor McGuire, has given clear instructions that further and additional consultation work and engagement work should take place beyond the work that was already undertaken and planned to further inform options before making any further decision. However, within the report that was presented to you, it does confirm that pre-decision consultation had taken place, communication plan was in place at the point, but this is to be extended. In terms of the financial aspects of the report, members have been informed that recommendations to take forward this option were set against the significant financial challenges the Borough Council faces, and the annual current revenue burden keeping these municipal golf courses open, which within the report is identified that these are discretionary services, the council is not under a part of progressing this decision by council